The following Conscious Consumer Network recording of a live broadcast is available to purchase in high definition at ethymarket.com. Support free and independent media by becoming a CCN pledger. For 10 euros a month, you can have unlimited access to CCN high definition downloads at ethymarket.com. Ethymarket, the ethical marketplace for conscious consumers.
This is For the Love of Learning, Voices of the Alternative Education Movement. Be inspired by the voices of visionaries, changemakers, and ordinary, extraordinary people who do what they do all for the love of learning.
This is For the Love of Learning, Voices of the Alternative Education Movement. I'm Lainey Liberty, and this is episode number 33. In this episode, we will explore lifelong learning for a changing world. If education is the process of learning and evolving, does not a changing world demand constant evolution? The question is not, does today's education prepare us for a changing world? The question should be, how, as individuals, can we make conscious choices to continue to grow, evolve, and meet the needs of a changing world as a lifelong pursuit? In this episode, we'll explore the differences, the experiences, and ideas and that inspire our panel of life learners, activists, visionaries, and facilitators as they strive to meet the needs of a changing world. The world is changing, and part of that means changes within a global context, which is characterized by the increased interconnectedness and interdependency of all people, societies, and cultures. In addition, we'll consider 21st century learning, the digital world, virtual worlds, a connected world, including immersive and experiential learning, and the relationship to a greater global perspective. What are the essential elements needed in order to enable and empower humans to be lifelong learners and active participants in our society? And just what does society need? I can't wait to get this discussion started. So I'm going to give a brief introduction to each of our panelists, then we'll start the conversation. Although these introductions are brief, we will have more information about each of our panelists on the show notes page located at consciousconsumernetwork.tv, and look for the show notes page for episode number 33. There you will find more extensive information about each of our panelists, their backgrounds, and links to their projects and websites. So first, I'd like to introduce you to Anna. Anna has been a panelist on the show twice before and is joining us tonight from Sweden. Anna is a teacher and the host of the blog, A Teacher's Journey to Life, and has over 15 years' experience within the educational system, including an undergraduate degree in pedagogy and a graduate degree in educational sociology. She is a contributor to the working class think tank, the Hamptons Institute, Department of Education, and is currently working on a publication in the International Journal of Progressive Education's Handbook. Anna calls herself a guerrilla teacher by day and a social net activist by night. She documents her journey daily on a variety of social media sites that share her insights and contribute to a meaningful and transformative discussion about education. So welcome back, Anna, as always. It's such a pleasure to have you here.
Hi, Lainey. Thank you so much for having me. Hi, everyone.
We're so happy you're part of this panel. So next, I'd like to introduce you to Zach. Zach is an entrepreneur and a writer focusing on issues of education, innovation, and philosophy. He is an Ivy League dropout and speaks and writes regularly on college, the negative effects of elite education, and how we can improve education for the individual and society at large. He believes that entrepreneurs are the primary actors of social change. Zach is a founding team member and business development director for Praxis. He has been published at Newsweek, the New York Examiner, the Daily Caller, the Pittsburgh Post-Gazette, the Christian Science Monitor, the Foundation for Economic Education's Anything Peaceful, among others. Welcome, Zach. We're thrilled you're part of tonight's panel.
I'm excited to contribute. I'm looking forward to it. Thanks for having me.
You're welcome. And finally, I'd like to introduce you to our third panelist. However, he has not logged in yet, and we're going to keep our fingers crossed that he can join us. We're just hoping that it's an issue with traffic. But let's go ahead and introduce Brandon. Brandon is the founder of the Black Daddies Club and brings over 10 years' experience working internationally with a background in leadership and facilitation, taking a transformative and equity approach to issues of marginalization, health, and wellness. Brandon focuses on anti-racist, anti-oppressive solutions across the board and views diversity, life transition, and marginalization as occasions to anchor communities with informed and responsive support. Brandon has been the founder of the Black Daddies Club and knows firsthand the importance of community cohesion. Bringing insight, analysis, and awareness, Brandon has been acknowledged by the African Canadian Achievement Award of Excellence, among others, and has been profiled by Global TV, TEDx Toronto, CBC Radio and Television, The Globe, The Toronto Sun, and Urbanology Magazine, to name a few, for bringing the voice of Black fathers into the spotlight. So we're hoping that Brandon joins us, and his introduction has been given, and the stage will be set. So tonight we have an incredibly diverse panel, but it will take this sort of diversity to tackle the topics of tonight's show. We're going to take on some very tough subjects tonight, and I'd like to establish a few sort of grand assumptions to see if everybody on this panel can agree to these assumptions in order to set the stage for the show. So the first assumption is, number one, the world is changing. Number two, with crystal clear intention and focused work, we can affect change in the most positive way. And number three, these changes are going to take the effort of a whole lot of people, and these people will have to be on a path of life learning. So is that okay, panel? And also, it looks like Brandon has joined us. So panel, are these assumptions okay?
Yeah, absolutely.
Fantastic. Brandon, you did not hear the introduction, and I'll chat with you in just a moment, but let's start the show.
Also, it looks like Brandon has joined us. So panel, are these assumptions okay?
Yeah, absolutely.
Fantastic. Brandon, you did not hear the introduction.
I did.
Moment, but let's start the show. Also, it looks like Brandon has joined us. So.
Okay, I'm sorry. That was a software loop where we were getting feedback. So we're going to start the show right now. Brandon, you did hear the assumptions, and everybody else has agreed to it. So we're going to start the show actually with Anna. Anna, I'm going to ask you the first question, and this is just going to, like I said, set the stage for tonight's conversation. So from your perspective, and everybody on this panel has such a unique perspective, but I really want to hear where you're coming from first. What are the biggest considerations we must first look at to consider the changing world we wish to see? And the second part of the question is, what does life learning look like from your perspective?
All right. So in looking at this question for me, what I would say is the first point of consideration is that, you know, throughout the course of human history, we've tried changing the world. We tried changing everything, the political systems or the economic systems, or create revolutions. And it seems as though we're not very successful at it, that every time we do, we revert back to the current paradigm or the current way of looking at things. And I would say that one of the reasons for that is that we take for granted that our point of view is objective or is this is just how it is, you know, and we need to change it. And so we try to just change the external or the outer paradigms without also changing ourselves. And so a big part of what I see is important to actually make a significant, substantial change is that we have to first work on de-schooling ourselves. So we basically have to unlearn, excuse my language, we have to unlearn all the crap that we've been taught. And it's a matter of looking at what condition, what state is the world in right now, and to realize that whatever it is that we're doing to ourselves and each other and to the planet, it comes from education. Everything can be traced back to the way that we were educated. As such, we have to look at what in our education brought us to where we are now. And that is the first point that we have to change. And if we as adults do that for ourselves and in our own lives, we too can set a different example for the children growing up. And in terms of life learning, I was looking at this for myself the other day, this expression, long time or lifelong learning, because I haven't exactly been a fan of it. It sounds a little bit forced, like you're in this program and you have to learn your entire life. But really, we cannot stop learning. Learning is something that happens naturally. And so I would say that the only situations where we don't learn is where we are stuck in a life or in a situation that we can't really get out of, and where everything is just on repeat day in and day out. But for most people, I would say that it is possible to learn on a daily basis, and it's something that we do without even thinking about it. It happens naturally. And so maybe the difference that is then that would then be supportive to implement is to do this actively and to be actively aware that we are always learning, and that learning is not per definition a positive or a constructive concept. We also learn a lot of bad habits. And so I would say that having that perspective of learning as being a natural thing that happens, take that into consideration. I would say that that's an important point to consider.
Great way to start the conversation. Thank you so much, Anna. And Zach, I'm going to jump over to you with the same question. Go ahead and share from your perspective what is involved in changing, participating in the change of a changing world, and what life learning looks like.
Yeah, no, there are at least a couple things here. And I want to start off by saying that there's kind of this contradiction when we talk about aggregates, especially aggregates of people. We say things like society. I realize I have society in my bio, which I was going to make the point that I hate using the phrase society. I hate the word society. Societies don't exist. They're just aggregates of individuals. But we don't want to try to push things. You know, Anna made the really good point that anytime people have tried to organize or push things in very organized, top-down manners for reforms or anything like that, it very rarely works over time. Like, things keep reverting back. And they keep reverting back to the system that people had originally tried to establish. And that's because societies, like, and to use the actual phrase of, like, a culture, are really, really complex, right? There's a lot of things going on into them. There's all these norms, there's all these mores, there's all these informal institutions, formal institutions, there's a lot going on. And they're usually created by, you know, decades, if not centuries, of people acting towards certain ends. So when I say that we need to do certain things, I'm not saying that, you know, there needs to be a central planner that designs society to work in a certain way. That will ultimately fail. That always fails. That's because societies are spontaneous orders more than they are designed constructivist orders. And I realize in education, the phrase constructivist means something different than in like a larger, almost like a political economy phrase. So I mean it more in the political economy sense as being like centrally planned or designed by somebody. So once we have that out of the picture and we realize that if we really start to break societies down, they're actually just largely aggregates of individual actors, right? I think for individual actors to kind of work in a changing world as life learners, however, whatever phrase we really want to use in that sense, I think that there's two really important things. One is allowing them to work in the formal institutions that are most conducive to learning, formal institutions being like schools, governments, laws, et cetera, informal institutions being like norms, mores, you know, informal institutions govern my friendship with somebody, a formal institution governs my relationship with my mailman, or a contractual relationship. So I think that one, we need to allow people to work in the right institutions. And I love that Anna actually used the phrase deschooling. I think that deschooling is exactly what needs to be done. I think that there's a couple things involved in that, and I can get into that later if we want to talk about that. I think there's at least three prongs for the individual to deschool themselves. But I think, too, the really important thing that culturally has become problematic is a lack of, to borrow a phrase from Peter Thiel, a lack of definite optimism, or lack of definiteness in general, right? People, and this is one thing schools do to people, so it's wrapped up in the deschooling concept, right? People drift through life not knowing what they want to achieve. And they keep pushing it off. They're like, oh, I just need to get a good grade on the next test. I need to get to the next grade. I need to get into the right college. I need to get into the right graduate school. But they never ask themselves why. It's very rare that people actually ask themselves, why do I want to get into that graduate school? Why do I want to get into that college? You know, my classmates, at the school I went to, a lot of them were hyper-competitive for jobs on like Wall Street or jobs in Boston or jobs in the federal government as paper-pushing bureaucrats. But they never asked themselves why. It's usually just because there's some sort of status to it, but they never really understood why they actually wanted that themselves. So there's sort of this individual introspection that's required for the individual then to go out and create the path that they need for themselves. If you have a definite path of where you want to go, something you want to achieve in your life, you have to learn to try to achieve that. If you don't learn, you won't achieve it. You can sit there and be like, I want to write the next great American novel, or I want to invent the next Uber or something like that. You can say that all day, but you never actually get there if you don't actually try to build that path. So.
Before we move on, I want to ask you something, Zach. You talk about being able to function within the institutions. Do you think the institutions themselves will be part of a changing world, or will that too change?
I'm not sure I completely understand the question, but I think that things like, especially in the United States, I can't really speak globally, but schools in the United States, whether we're looking at compulsory K-12 or coercive K-12 systems, or we're looking at collegiate university systems, they don't have, what's the incentive for them to change? they actually have incentives not to change. You occasionally get reformers that come through and try to push through some changes, or you might get like a billionaire like Mark Zuckerberg who donates millions of dollars to some school system in New Jersey. But they actually have incentives not to change, right? There's at least three things working here for social change in general, right? There's institutions, there's individuals, and four things. Institutions, individuals, incentives, and ideas. The individuals are the actors. They're actors in certain institutions. They act in certain ways based on the incentives that act on the institution. The ideas define the incentives on the institution. So I don't think so. I think that it's the best thing that people can do if you're like a parent and you find this problematic, or you're going to be a parent, is homeschool your kids. Legally homeschool them, but actually unschool them. That's what I'm largely an advocate for.
Oh, okay. Sorry about that. I was muted there. Yeah, no, I would also like to comment on that point. Because this is something that I look at as an activist and that I've been looking at for years, right? Because we have, in terms of going about like structural fundamental changes of our systems, we have a couple of different ways of going about it. We have the violent revolutions that I was talking about earlier that hasn't worked. And then, you know, you're asking whether we could do that within the very institutions. And the way I see it, we kind of have to, because they're so cemented in the world system, at least at the moment, especially when it comes to bureaucracy and legislation. You know, for example, here in Sweden, it's not allowed to homeschool your child. You will get fined. Potentially, you can, as a parent, be sent to jail if you homeschool your child. So that like that structure, I cannot go up against. You know, it would take a massive uproar from the people to go up against it. So, you know, what I've then been looking at and what I'm working with is what I call unschooling the school system. And this is also because I see that there are a lot of people who aren't able to homeschool. And if all the people like us who has some kind of raised awareness, if we can dare to say that we do, and I think that a lot of people these days are starting to sort of wake up, if you will have it. But if we all move out of the public schools and off the grid and into a, you know, this secluded community of other people who have awakened, what about the rest? And I'm certainly not speaking against it. If you're able to do it, and that is kind of part of your activism, I know that you're, for example, doing that, Lainey, and as a spokesperson for world schooling as well, definitely do it. Though at the same time, we have a responsibility to transform the institutions that are here. We cannot simply leave them, you know, and then they're supposed to dissolve or disintegrate or deconstruct themselves. You know, that's not going to happen. So they were created by human beings, and they have to be changed from within by human beings. And that is what we can do as parents and teachers, and wherever we find ourselves, university students, we can actually do that from within on an individual level. But we can come back to that as well on a later stage.
Yeah, I mean, I would just like to pose two counterpoints to that. The first would be more of a normative question, like, why do we have to do that for those institutions? I think there's this kind of underlying assumption that we owe some sort of responsibility to institutions that we had no part in creating or opting into. If that's the case, then I don't think that people do necessarily have obligations to those institutions or to preserve them or to promote them. The second would be, if you actually look at broad social change over history that has actually of the slave trade in the Western Hemisphere, with one very clear, very large exception, some smaller exceptions in like the Caribbean, the one very clear, very large one being the United States Civil War. A lot of it just kind of fizzled away because people stopped believing in the institution. People just stopped. Again, if we go back to those four I's that I noted, you have incentives, individuals, institutions, and ideas. People's ideas changed, and very few incentives to participate in the institution anymore. So I think the idea of these institutions just crumbling on themselves isn't necessarily appalling, and I think that one of the great things about technology, and we get into this too later, one of the great things about technology is it allows people to outmaneuver coercive state institutions fairly quickly. It might be illegal technically in a lot of places, but there's a lot of ways to work around it. And I think that if we really do look at schools as potentially dangerous as they are, then not only can you do it, but you might have a moral obligation to do it.
Yeah, there are so many different points great points that you just made. Before we get too far down one path, I'd like to bring Brandon into the conversation and go back to the first question and pose that to you, Brandon. Could you share with us from your perspective what a changing world looks like and what needs to happen to make the world be this place that actually has progressed in such a way that you'd like to see? And how does life learning play into that? What role does life learning play within the changes that we're looking at?
So first of all, thanks for having me, and my apologies for causing the commotion early on. I think as a father and as an activist, I think there's a piece to kind of push back on this traditional way of learning, right? Like, speaking from a Canadian context, I know how institutions can be detrimental, right? So, like, if you look at residential schools here in Canada, where you had, Christian settlers going into First Nation and Aboriginal community and basically trying to put on their beliefs and trying to take away or strip culture, right? And I think for me, there's an importance to reframe how we approach and think about knowledge, right? And who are the knowledge givers and who are the knowledge receivers, right? So again, seeing there's this traditional sense of Indigenous knowledge being seen being secondary or less than a Eurocentric approach, where I think there has to be a reframing of that, right? There has to be a reframing of thinking about just restructuring how we approach knowledge. So to give an example, starting last summer, the Black Daddies Club, we started to do these weekly hikes in the summer where dads and our kids, we go into the forest and we just walk for a couple hours every Sunday. And it's really, the whole idea for me anyways, it's to get my kids and other kids detach from the computers basically and reattach to nature. And also looking at nature and spending time in nature and meditate and see what knowledge can we get from nature, right? I think there's a shift here in Toronto that I'm seeing to more homeschooling, and also to look at moving from institutional knowledge or institutional conversations to more kitchen table dialogues, right? And community building. So moving from this idea that it has to be like this very, like, you know, these huge huge corporations where it's like large numbers to like small communities, you know, 5-6 people around a kitchen table and sharing knowledge that way, you know? So, I'm going to stop right there.
Well, what I find really fascinating is we've got Zach coming at it from a real entrepreneurial perspective. We've got Anna coming at it from changing the institution from the inside. And we're looking at your perspective, Brandon, where you're talking about changing the world from the hearts and souls of the people that you work with. Can you talk about why you feel some of these, or why you feel that this is the best approach to create the change that you want to see?
This is for myself, yeah? So I think there is, again, so my work with Black fathers, really a big part of that is storytelling, right? So again, the popular narrative for Black fathers in Toronto, and I can speak for North America, is that we're non-existent, right? That we're not present. However, you know, when you start to have dialogues with dads, you start seeing that that's not the case, you know? So there's an importance of these men starting to sharing their stories. So we just did this documentary called Black Men Loving, and it's the whole premise of it is about these different Black fathers, from straight to gay to different voices, basically disrupting this popular narrative, right? To challenge that. And I think that the idea behind that is then we have to start creating new knowledge. I think that's the exciting part of this work is in terms of challenging the status quo of what we consider what knowledge is. And putting that on top of its head, basically. So I really think what you're doing with your son in terms of this world schooling, I think is so dope. You know what I'm saying? Which is something that I definitely want to do with my three boys, because I think there has to be a point before you continue, as Zach was saying, in terms of like you have a lot of folks, whether it's in, you know, law school, doing the MBAs or just higher education, that you're just kind of going through the motions, but you're not necessarily digging deep to figure out what's your place in this world, right? And I think traveling and unlearning and learning to kind of think about, like, do more self-work, right? And I think schools are not necessarily pushing that agenda, right? So I think as a parent, I'm always having these dialogues with my kids to talk about, you know, things like masculinity. You know what I'm saying? Like, it's like really having these very, you know, these dialogues that we take for granted, but they're a huge piece. For me, I'm doing self-love and Black masculinity, and for me, that dialogue excites me, right? Because I think that for something that's so simple and we use it in daily context, we realize that the more we have dialogues is that we're all come from different places. So we need to like centralize and start having these dialogues, basically, you know?
Yeah. And you've all, each one of you have talked about introspection as a part of life learning. I actually want to just shift the focus a little bit, and both, Anna and Zach have talked about de-schooling. I want to talk about what life learning constitutes. What makes up, what is the heart and soul of life learning, and how would each of our panelists define this concept of life learning? And why don't we jump to you first, Zach?
Yeah, I'm happy to address a couple things there. The first would be, I think that in order for somebody to have that kind of definite optimism I was talking about, assuming somebody's optimistic about their life, I would hope somebody is, like that they want to achieve things in the future. In order to actually build that kind of plan for themselves, they need to have self-esteem. I think self-esteem is at the core of being de-schooled, being a life learner, whatever you want to call it. I like the phrase de-schooling, but I actually don't like it because it kind of sounds like an anti-concept, right? It's like, you can't have de-schooling without schooling, unfortunately. So whatever kind of individual-based pedagogical perspective you want to have there, or learning perspective you want to have, we can say de-schooling, whatever. But I think self-esteem is important. I think self-esteem is important for a couple reasons. The first is that if you have a vision for your future, but you lack self-esteem, you're not going to be able to tell yourself, oh, I can actually achieve that. And I don't mean self-esteem in like the cheesy sense, right? In the sense that we're going to be sitting at a straight line leadership conference and they're going to be telling us, you know, you need self-esteem. I mean the individual's ability to look at themselves as somebody that they like, right? That they're somebody they're proud of being, that they're somebody who lives with integrity. Schools make this very difficult for people. One, they collectivize people, turn them into aggregates. You know, this class got an average test score of this, this class got an average test score of that. This is your student number, that's your student number. Schools are essentially microcosms for states, right? Everything horrible that you can imagine that a state has ever done, schooling has been a pretty big part of that. So I think it's really important for the individual to have self-esteem. At the same time, I think it's also really important for the individual to be working in these kinds of informal institutions I mentioned before. Brandon actually brought up a really great point. And he talked about the formal schools that were kind of imposed upon the indigenous communities in Canada, that were imposed by the settlers in their own communities and uprooted a lot of the cultural institutions that were already there, right? This goes kind of back to what Anna was saying too. If you actually look at times that this has been done, it very rarely works out for what the colonizing forces want. There's actually a really great paper, if anybody watching is like into economics, there's a really great paper by an economist named Peter Leeson called, I think the name of the paper is Human Sacrifice. And he looked at, it sounds funny. It's not actually about education, but it's about this kind of informal versus formal institution thing. He looked at colonizing forces in Africa that went into these small communities that did actually do some kind of human sacrifice, right? And they tried to ban it outright. And their efforts failed. There were all these different problems that cropped up from it. Violence spiked in the community. There were still, people were still getting killed, right? By their peers and by their community members, which ideally when you ban human sacrifice, there will be less killing, right? So what they did was they went in and they imposed this formal institution of theirs on the informal institution, which was a violence reduction mechanism that that community had developed over hundreds or thousands of years. So once they actually lifted the ban and allowed like some sort of common law, some sort of law among the community members, not imposed by the colonists, to happen, they were actually able to get much better results. And I think that works not only on a societal level, but I think it works on an individual level. What you want to get as an individual, you need a plan to get there. But that plan, you're not a lottery ticket. That plan cannot be standardized down to you. That plan cannot be pulled from an aggregate. You come with a very specific set of background experiences, a very specific set of things you want to achieve. You need to be in an informal institution that allows you to learn these things and gives you the incentives to learn these things. For me, I think that's the marketplace. Marketplaces are great examples of informal institutions. People think of marketplaces are about like greed or money. No. That's a misconception. Some are when they're bastardized with formal institutions, but a marketplace is at its core a way for people to transmit knowledge. That's what I was looking for people to transmit knowledge. If you just look at, there's another great thing that viewers should look at called iPencil that talks about this. Like, how do you build a pencil? Well, if you don't have a marketplace that tells you like prices of goods to tell you how much there actually are out there, you're not going to be able to know which resources you need. That works for individual skills too. There's a marketplace in labor. And it goes both ways. So if you see, computer engineer makes X number of dollars per year, but a librarian makes Y number of dollars per year, there's a reason why those numbers are higher or lower. That's communicating some kind of knowledge to people. I think marketplaces are probably the best place for people to have those kinds of institutions on them.
Anna, would you like to chime in? Share your thoughts about what constitutes life learning?
Yeah, well, I talked a little bit about that before. We can bring it down to quite basic terms, right? So as we come into this world, we have to learn how to function. We have to learn how to speak and walk and integrate in society and participate in the world and be not necessarily productive or, you know, beneficial members of the society, but at least not be disruptive. And I'm saying this from the perspective of the current education system that does not allow us to develop our potential or really allow our potential to come into fruition in any way. Like we are educated at the moment to be functional in a dysfunctional world. So, I mean, so life learning is, first of all, it's a matter of learning how to navigate life, right? Life as we know it. But it's kind of like we've never really gotten into the potential of what education can be. Because if we look at the course of human history, we have sort of put ourselves on this throne or on this pedestal of knowledge, believe because we, you know, we don't have anything to compare with. There are no superior alien race that we can look upon and see ourselves as inferior. So we see ourselves as this great, magnificent being that has evolved with this amazing mind that separates us from the animals. And so we categorized and we ordered everything in our world. And, you know, at some point we were rather satisfied that now we understand the world and we understand everything in it and we understand the laws of physics. And now we just, you know, now we just keep inventing based on that. Now we just keep creating new technologies. But how much do we really know about life? You know, when you say life learning, it's like, I mean, the way that we're currently living on this planet with the destructive forces that we come with to it, I mean, that indicates or implies that we actually don't know a lot about life. Because if we did know about life, we wouldn't destroy our own habitat. So I would say that there's an entire process of education that we haven't yet even begun exploring, which would be the question of what can life be? What can life be when it thrives in its utmost potential, in its utmost way? And that is, I mean, that's why I'm here. That is what I would like to explore. But there are some steps that we have to take in order to get there. But step number one, of course, is realizing that, you know, okay, it's not like everything that we learned thus far is useless, but that we're not done. You know, we haven't yet even started, and so we shouldn't take what we think we know for granted. Quantum physics is a really good example of that, but it's still very in its infant stages as well. But so I kind of see life learning in a more holistic context, you know, so not necessarily so much life as the span of a human experience from when you're born until you die, because even that, you know, is part of a greater context. And a friend of mine once said a couple of years ago, and that really stuck with me because it's so true. And I'm going to use some curse words here. So if you don't want to hear it, mute or turn down your volume. But she said, you know, in kind of this frustration, you know, we're born and then we have a fucked up life experience, which means, you know, we go about our business and we're completely unaware and we're, you know, walking around lots like zombies, and then we die and what remains is the system. You know, so we go through all of this motion, you know, we're born and we do all the things that we're supposed to do, or we get off track. And then we die. But what always lives, what always continues, is the same system, the same way of approaching life, of extracting resources. And I think that's a really important point to make, is to put all of this into a much larger context. Because when we do that, we can see that things aren't, you know, my life, my little piece of the word or of the world or the earth, is not separate from everything else. And there's a reason why it is, I have the opportunities that I have, that I'm in the conditions that I am. And I think it's very important to not lose sight of that when you look at the word life. You know, because from my perspective, we don't really yet know what that means. As I would say that life has to do with nurture, it has to do with expansion, it has to do with growing and raising. You know, that is what we know as the symbol of life, like a seed being planted and growing. But that is not what we're doing at the moment. We're not really yet perhaps alive.
I think Anna said some like really interesting things just now, and it made me think of a few years ago. There was this really dope author, indigenous author named Andrea Smith, and she wrote this book called Conquest. And she was giving a talk, and someone asked a question. You know, how do we get rid of capitalism? Right, like this huge question, and her response was that we have to learn how to like decolonize our imagination, right? And I thought that was like a really dope concept, because in a sense of like, we have these different systems that we're living in, right? And we're being taught to kind of to carry on these systems, right? But I think it's important for us to do this work, or the work that I'm interested in doing is creating new systems, right? That gives me, as a person of color, some kind of leverage, some kind of space, some voice, right? And think about a different kind of reality. And I think that's the piece. I don't think we can say, yeah, we're doing revolutionary work if we're working in the same messed up system and trying to produce the same messed up conclusions, right? I think we have to be somewhat radical in our approach and unlearn a lot of the stuff that we've been taking in. But I do think it's decolonizing our minds is a big part of it. And we have to look at about this work of like doing things different and creating some new systems, essentially, right?
Yeah, one of the reasons why I really wanted to have this conversation is everybody on this panel can agree that the systems are shifting and there's discontent within the systems, which means we're on the cusp of a paradigm shift. And I would doubt that every person on this panel believes that this shift is going to look the same. We're all going to see it through our own eyes, through our own worldviews, through our own perspectives. And the reason why I think life learning or this conversation is important is because through our continuous learning and reassessing and adding more information as experiences happen, that will affect change. We don't stop learning when we leave high school. And if we can remember that we're learning intellectually, we're learning emotionally, we're learning new systems and complexities, that in my opinion, that gives us the power to empower the changes that we want to see. I'm going to hand the floor over to the next person who would like to speak. Anna?
Yeah, so I think it's a really interesting point, and it's kind of it's kind of contradictory, because I don't know, but it's like you have the way that I've understood from my academic background, the way that because we had courses on lifelong learning. I know that you're not talking about lifelong learning as a concept, but more the actual reality of learning, right? But it's kind of interesting because the way that it was introduced, it was sort of this top-down thing that the government now came with, you know. Now everybody has to participate in lifelong learning, which in my mind basically translated to, oh, great. So now there's more brainwashing. Like now we're not, they don't leave us after high school. Now we have to, and I mean, of course it happens anyway, but now it was more, you know, being translated into this positive new concept. But I will say this. So, I mean, we go about our day, we engage in our worlds, we look at advertisements or the internet or television, and through all of those channels and all of those mediums, we are learning, not necessarily as fast as we were able to or in the best capacity, but we do constantly take in input from our world. We might even be learning the same lessons over and over again. So I really agree with what you're saying, Lainey, is that we have to become aware of this concept and basically take learning into our own hands. And that this is why, you know, for me, the internet is the greatest invention ever in the history of mankind, because I now have the power of education in my hands. If I want to learn how to raise chickens or fix my car or fix my washing machine, I now have the opportunity to do that smoothly and easily. I can empower myself on so many levels because of the access to information that the internet offers. And through that, it's like for the first time we actually have the opportunity on a practical level to become our own educators and say, what media channels is it that I want to take information from to best orientate myself on what's going on in the world? Or even, maybe even better, look at all kinds of different media channels to get a holistic perspective as possible. I think that is awesome. And I think especially when it comes to children, that is a step that we haven't yet taken. And that is, maybe we can discuss this as well later, because children, and especially older children, already, they're all over the internet, you know, it's in their bloodstream. And yet we're not harnessing that. We're not standing by them. And it's more like a battle, you know, between adult and children. And we talk about screen time instead of actually, you know, supporting them to take education into their own hands and become their own learning institutions. As we as adults are more facilitators, and we stand as sort of these funnels, you know, that makes information available and that makes methods of discerning information available to them. And I think that is, for a lot of adults, it's a scary concept to actually hand over the power of learning to a child. And within that, we also realize that, you know, and maybe this is why we don't do it, is that we didn't have the power to begin with. And we didn't know, you know, we are not these all-knowing creatures, and that can be tough to admit. But once we do, we can begin an awesome learning process together. Like with my students, you know, when we explore concepts, we're learning together. Right now we're investigating being critical towards sources, and I'm learning as much as they're learning, and it's a matter of exploring together. And I find that to be very empowering, so that live learning spans across all generations and is something that we're doing together, because we realize that, you know, we have to equalize.
Yeah, there's a lot of good stuff here when we talk about what this kind of like paradigm shift, if you want to call it that, it can look like. Like there's a lot of people who've written on it. Like Peter Diamandis is one who writes about we're at the cusp of what he calls, and what others call, the singularity, where $1,000 computer will have more computing power than the human mind. It's just the extension of Moore's law, that every X number of years, $1,000 computer is twice as powerful than one of those number of years ago. And like the great thing about the internet is that makes me optimistic, and the great thing about technology in general, I don't think it's a panacea. We just need to throw more computers in the classroom. I remember when I was in high school, the school got a lot of grant money and just started replacing everything. Just threw money into the school, and they're like, look, we have smart boards now. It's like somehow we're a better school. Ooh. Rather than a chalkboard, it's a touch board that you use a $4,000 projector on. But what does the internet do, and what does technology do in general? Not just in learning, but in everything that we think about. It lowers transaction costs, right? It lowers the transaction cost for me to engage in learning about a new topic. Whereas before, you could make the argument that you needed something like schools. I don't think you can ever really make a good argument that you needed universal compulsory schooling. But you could make the argument that before the rise of the internet, you needed something like schools, because that's the best way of lowering transaction costs. Get an expert in one place that everybody can come to, and you can teach many people at once. The internet makes it that you can bring that transaction cost down to essentially zero. Like I said, it's not just learning that this happens in. Think about you know, one of my favorite examples is in just markets in general. And I think a market in education is exactly what needs to happen. Look at Uber, right? People can talk about, you know, the poor management practices of Uber as much as they want, but you actually look at what Uber did was they lowered the transaction cost to getting a car so much that they actually created a new market. Their marketplace isn't taxis. Their marketplace is people who are willing to get into a stranger's car and then pay them to take you somewhere. They lowered that transaction cost. I can go on my phone right now and all I have to do is click two buttons and a car will pull up outside of my house. If you had something like that for education, I hate the idea of like Uber for X, that's one of those jargon words. Oh, we need Uber for education. That's not what I'm saying. But the more that you can lower transaction costs for education, the better. Because you actually create new markets, new systems, new institutions that people will operate in. The other thing is, I think it's Anna raised this point about children nowadays, Generation Z, who were like raised totally in the internet. I remember dial tones. I barely remember dial tones, but I remember dial tones. I was actually sitting in an office recently and I heard a fax machine go off and it was like, wow, I haven't heard that in years. Felt like it was something out of Apocalypse Now. But I remember dial tones. Younger children don't remember dial tones. They've been so totally raised in the internet that that's the mindset they come at things with. And that very modular mindset, that very modular mindset with incredibly low transaction costs. So their entire approach to education is going to be so totally different than one that was built by essentially baby boomers. The education system in the United States today and in a lot of places in the world is built by the baby boomers. It's built by a greatest generation of baby boomers, people post World War II. And those people are incredibly risk averse. Those people, remember a pre-internet world. those are people who remember a pre-computer world. If you just look at the generational differences between baby boomers as a whole, and again, I'm collectivizing, which I know I just opened up saying I don't like doing, but if you look at like the cultural definitions of a baby boomer, they're very risk averse. They're very opposed to like new things cropping up. And I think the best thing that can happen is them to be pushed out of the workforce. One of the things I deal with a lot at Praxis, what we do is we take young people who may or may not have college degrees and we get them really, really cool jobs at startups and small and medium-sized businesses where they essentially are like apprentices. And the largest constraint to their success is an HR person who's almost always a baby boomer, who is almost always somebody that's like, well, you know, you went through this kind of system, but this is the one that I've come to trust. The founders, the entrepreneurs, the people who have built the businesses think it's awesome. But as soon as you hit that HR person, then it becomes problematic. And it's a boomer mindset. HR as a field didn't crop up until during the boomers. So it's a little long-winded, but boomers, lower transaction costs, important.
Great points. And it's funny because I worked in technology for almost 20 years before I wrote the first dot-com boom and the crash, actually both of them. So I know exactly the cultures you're talking about, Zach. But Anna brought up a really good point about technology in education. As parents, we want to, you know, limit our children's screen time. Actually, I don't. But most parents are looking at screen time as something that needs to be limited. And there seems to be a disconnect between the idea of technology being a tool for learning and empowering self-learning, and which leads to life learning, where going back to the old paradigm, learning is something that's controlled by the institution and governed by the institution. So I think that's where we're looking at the systematic change. I think it's going to happen within our young people first, right? They are taking initiative, and they are empowering themselves through their own self-guided journeys based on whatever it is that they want to find, because technology has really enabled a different way of learning that, you know, those of us that are, I'm Gen X, you know, Yeah, I grew up with technology, but I remember when there wasn't technology. And I was just talking to my son about the first video game. I mean, I remembered Pong. It was pretty awesome, you know. But if we're looking at technology, I think that is part of the paradigm shift. And I want to actually hand the floor over to Brandon. I'd like to hear from you and what your thoughts were within your community, within a community of color or a specific community within Canada, and what have you noticed in terms of technology paving a way for a new means of learning?
Yeah, so I think technology, I was making notes regarding the other question that I thought was coming up, the consumerism versus citizenship. But the in terms of technology, I know for, like, say, like during the summertime, I have three boys, right? So 13, 11, and 9. And it's important for me to, like, you know, these guys are like all about Roblox and like Minecraft, and you know, I've seen how like technology is sort of, you know, has influenced like even their concept of community, right? So like they have neighbors, like we have neighbors just like two houses down. Like these guys would like go and go on Roblox, and like they're having like this community, the online community. And they're working collaboratively. But there was also a study done by the Toronto District School Board a few summers ago that talked about marginalized kids when they leave school in June and then they return to school in September. When they did like a benchmark of marginalized kids versus more affluent children, their test mark was that the kids were more affluent, the test marks were higher in September, right? And there was like a dip with the marginalized kids. And for me, and talking to other, you know, other parents, we've like utilized online formats such as, you know, Khan Academy or these different online pieces to get our kids like just practicing during the summer, right? And I even think Roblox and Minecraft, those things have like a piece to play. But again, I think I'm kind of torn with the online piece, because as a parent, like I like that idea. I grew up in Jamaica, right? So I grew up with, you know, come summertime, I wasn't necessarily in the house. I was like outdoors. I was like, you know, the hiking or in nature. And I think that is something that you can't necessarily substitute with technology, not as yet anyways, right? So I think there has to be some kind of balance to have, you know, kids getting the best of outdoors and this technological piece, right? Because then, yeah, I think just in terms of the social skills, I think it's also like I've talked to people, not just young people, but I feel like, you know, people are when we think about community, people are very okay to be like, we're Facebook friends or social media friends. And then you see this person in person on the train and you're like, hey, what's going on? And they're like, hey, you know, that's too much, right? Like, I think that's sort of this thing where it's sort of like, how do we get deeper and with relationships, right? I think that's also a piece where, again, technology is great, but it can be a barrier as well, right? It can distance you, and there's a lot of people who are like dying in isolation out there, basically. Even though they have like 4,000 friends on social media, like you can't really. There's not necessarily that contact, that hug that we may need sometimes. But yeah.
Yeah, I would like to offer or present a solution to that problem, because as I see it, the issue with that is kind of that we see kids being in nature or let's say physical reality as being opposed. Like we see it as these two conflictual worlds, right? That are, you know, that cannot harmonize. But the way that I see it, and also the way that I see kids interacting with digital technologies, is that it actually becomes integrated. You know, so we don't have to see it as two separate worlds that cannot or that influence each other negatively. And I think with kids especially, it's a matter of being creative with the way that you use technology and the way that you work with technology in terms of showing them how this integration can happen. And then also in terms of what you're saying, Brandon, with social media and how there's, you know, that human contact is missing. I think that's something just like we were talking about earlier with how we actively have to take learning into our own hands. This is also something that we actively have to take into our own hands in terms of shaping what kind of participation do I want on social media? Who do I want to be? Or like Zach was talking about earlier, defining the why. So for example, for me, I use social media as an activist. So everything that I do online, okay, maybe not everything. There are the occasional cat video and a cute baby that I get, the black hole that I get sucked into, as everyone probably does. But I'm very aware of this point that you're making, Brandon, in how there is a distance between my physical world and my online world. However, at the same time, you know, if you follow me on Facebook, you know that I lay out my life completely openly. And I recently met some people from Facebook that I'm Facebook friends with. And it was very interesting to see how we were able to establish a much more intimate contact because they already knew everything about me. They know, you know, what I'm busy doing in my life. They know how my husband looks like. They know what animals that I have. They know my perspective on education already because I can't help sharing it. And I found that to be such a cool experience. So I think that what we have to do is that, you know, to be more inventive and more creative in using the social media platforms to establish connections in our practical lives. So what I do, you know, for example, signing up for a tango class, or the other day I started looking for, I like playing board games. So I've looked up board game groups or put up an ad on a Facebook group, you know, seeing if someone wants to come and play board games with me. And the responses were amazing. And I think it's exactly because of what you say, that people are so isolated, but that's also why it's so important that there are people who sort of make the connections happen, and to not in that see the digital world as separate from the physical world, but as kind of see, you know, the digital world is like a representation or an expansion of the physical world, and it doesn't have to be in its conflictual in any way. It should be, from my perspective, supportive. So that's also why, you know, the way that I engage, for example, with my smartphone is that I don't have a lot of things on there that distract me. I did when I first got it, you know, because it was new. So I played games, but more and more and more I'm using it for things that optimize my practical life, that makes it more practical for me to be an activist and connect with people. And I think that that's also the message, you know, to promote to the younger generations, because it's just like everything else, you know, that they will use entertainment the way that it is being promoted by producers and manufacturers, the same way that they will engage with porn and candy and all these things that can be consumed in a supportive way, but that is being pushed at them to become zombies, to become isolated, and because that's the whole point, right? So that we don't go into communities, so that we don't gather, so that we don't get face to face and you know, become vulnerable and actually see each other, because that is where the real power to change this world exists. So that's what we can do, as I see it, as adults, is to set that example, because I think that that's where it comes from kids, that they see the way that we engage with technology and how, you know, the adult that stands with their phone and, you know, the child picks up on the fact that you would rather be there than here with me. And so, you know, you have to say, no, this is a tool. This is a tool that I use to better be in contact with you. Yeah. So a little perspective on that.
I want to just jump in on that piece in terms of, because I was listening to what you're saying in terms of this integration of these two ideas. But I think for me, whether it's on the online community or in this like real life face-to-face, there's a problem in terms of, and you kind of touched on it, Anna, in terms of vulnerability, right? So in August, I went to attend this conference in Portugal, and it was on reimagining higher education, right? And it was 50 different people from 50 parts of the world, dope people. However, the one, like, you know, who are doing great work. And the one thing I recognized from day one was that a lot of us were feeling lonely, right? A lot of us were doing this work, but in isolation, didn't feel like we have a community. And what I mean by that, you know, there's this term that we throw out a lot in terms of creating safe spaces, right? However, I don't think that really exists, right? I think there's a vulnerability that is needed. And a lot of us, including myself, like traditionally has been scared to be vulnerable in some spaces, especially when I'm doing work. And also recognizing that here in this real world that you have to put on these masks, right? Like we have these masks, a lot of us wear these masks for survival. But when I was in Portugal at this particular venue, it was in this area called Tamara, which is this intentional community, which has this focus on free love and open love. And what was interesting to me was this commitment to openness, transparency, trust, and honesty, right? And it was like this surreal experience having these really deep and vulnerable conversation with folks that I was just meeting for like for 5 minutes. And saying stuff, and you know that people here, like you know, my community here doesn't know whether it's online or face to face. And I think it's going back to these, you know, reimagining of what community looks like. You know, how do we start to be able to take off these masks, right, and have these authentic dialogues with folks, and then actually build with people on a different level? Because when we talk about social media, outside of the cats and the cute stuff, it's all about posting like these very coming from a place of control, a place of ego, I want to call it, right, versus being really vulnerable and really saying, you know, I'm having this really shitty day and I need support, you know what I'm saying, like really going back to the kitchen table. And I think that for me is like, I think that's the interesting piece around this unlearning when we're talking about is how to really connect, right? It's like getting off the soapbox and not necessarily trying to be, you know, I don't know, like I have a problem. So when I went to Costa Rica last year and I did, we spent all these different, like we spent some time and a lot of time in nature. It took, when I got back to school, and I was sitting with, you know, these masters and PhD students, it was really hard for me to engage in a dialogue, right? Because here was folks, like brilliant folks using these like huge words and this vibe of like, yo, this is how smart I am, right? And it was hard for me to get down in that space because for the last 4 weeks when I was in Costa Rica, I was learning a different way, like spending time from nature, learning from nature, and then learning for myself, right? and marrying those things, and going into like the classrooms, I was getting detached from that. I was getting detached from myself. I was getting detached from like listening. So I think it's this piece around unlearning for me. There's a piece around authenticity that's missing, right? Anywho.
So one of the things that has been creeping around the background, there was a moment there where my my connection slowed down, so maybe it was mentioned. But on this topic is the difference between like being enamored in your Twitter feed and on Facebook all the time as one way of using your screen, right? And the importance of video games and the importance of play with video games. And I know I'm somebody who like loves to be outdoors, and I love doing things, being outdoors, you know, growing up. I wish there, looking back, there are times when I wish, oh, I wish I could spend time outdoors. Simultaneously, a lot of what I've learned, and I'm probably the youngest person here, so I probably speak to this a little bit better, but even then, like the kids nowadays, just shaking my cane, way over my head with some video games. But I remember a lot of what I've learned and been able to learn applying my life and made me like who I am came from my ability to engage in video games, both with other people and building communities that way. I remember when I was younger, my family was moving around a lot and staying in the same general area, but still a lot of tumultuous stuff going on in my life. One of the few communities I was able to look to very sturdily was actually a message forum for one of the video games I liked. Simultaneously, a lot of what I learned too that I applied to this very day in my job, that I applied in school, that influenced like how I've developed intellectually, I learned from the video games I play. So one of the points I said earlier that there are like some things wrapped up in what unschooling is, and one of those points that's very, very, not unschooling, I'm sorry, deschooling. One of those points is play and the importance of play. And play can come any number of ways. You can play being outdoors, running around, hiking. That's really important play. And I think if you view video games and a video game and a gaming mindset as play, it's one of the best ways that somebody can learn. So I just want to parse those two apart. Yeah, you know, sitting on Facebook all day and just clicking like on people's pictures of cats. Or them saying like my life is so wonderful when in reality it's complicated like everybody's is one thing, and then the other is I really do think that video games allow us to get into a certain level of play that is almost impossible to replicate in the real world. So any too much of anything's a bad thing, right? And I do think that there is definitely a happy place for having technology.
I agree. And I think that's one of the things that Brandon alluded to, which is the balance of all things. I do want to remind our audience, though, I can't remember which episode, we did a show, a previous show for the Love of Learning on play, and Dr. Peter Gray, one of the lead researchers on play, in the beginning of the show gives a beautiful definition as to what constitutes play. And he gave, I think it was 5 or 6 very succinct points. So if you want to explore the connection between play and learning, I invite you to go find that show on our archives and watch it. It's a beautiful show. Before we get too far down one path, I do really want to bring back a question that I intended to ask a little bit earlier on. This has been a great conversation about technology, but I really want to shift gears and look at the responsibilities between, let's say, citizenship and consumerism. This is a very powerful theme that runs, especially in the Western cultures, where you know, if we're functioning within a system, and if we agree that the system stays the same, this is how we're expected to participate in the system. And there isn't a whole lot of room for life learning, and there isn't a whole lot of room for changing within that system, in my opinion. Again, I want to bring this question. I mean, it's not really a specific question. It's more of a philosophical exploration. You know, where do you think the roads between consumerism and the road between citizenship and the responsibilities of both meet, and what does that look like in a changing world? And we'll go to Anna first.
Yeah, so if I look at the two, you could say, individual positions of, you know, being a citizen or being a consumer, at least if we look at it hypothetically or like potentially, okay? So I'm not talking in absolute terms or in the, you know, entire course of history of these definitions, because I know that, for example, with the word citizen, you know, that's a huge topic in itself. But just off the bat, my own perspective, I kind of see the word consumer as a very passive, you know, receptive. It's kind of very linked to the word entertainment as well. So a consumer, you know, is someone that sits and consumes and takes stuff in. You know, that's so nice. That's so good. It's very passive. And then citizen, at least as a potential, has the promise or the possibility of being an active, equal member of community. So as a citizen, it's like it kind of automatically says that you have a vote, that you have a voice, that you have a responsibility to your community. So it's a completely different position as an individual in terms of whether you see or define yourself or whether you act within the one role of being a consumer on the one role of being a citizen. And I think the problem is that you know, the consumer role is what we're constantly being presented with from, you know, all kinds of outlets as a natural. Like, that's it is who we are. And especially in the Western countries where we have access to resources and money, you know, it's like this life and the world is like this theme park kind of that you walk into and there are all these things and colors and wow. And we don't really question the fact that we define ourselves as consumers because it's sort of a positive, you know, we're benefiting from it. There's a lot of fun and a lot of excitement that comes from that. But we don't really discuss the premises of it, the consequences of it, how it affects the way that we, you know, I would say that we become pacified. It is like, it works like a pacifier. And then you have the word citizen on the other hand, but that is, you know, in most countries, it is also a passive position because it is an assignment. It's a role that is assigned to you from a higher authority. And it is very often seen in the sense that you have a responsibility to your government, to your country. And, you know, we've probably all heard that saying, you know, like if you want to, I remember one time where I was like, I don't want to work. I don't see, you know, I was a teenager and I didn't see the point of having to slave the rest of my life away. I wanted to do something meaningful. And I remember an adult, maybe it was one of the baby boomers that Zach mentioned earlier, that said, but imagine if everyone did that, you know, where would we be? So it's kind of this, you know, being a citizen is also not a very uplifting role to give yourself. And I think that what would be really fruitful and beneficial is, you know, if we take these concepts and we redefine them. And I would say that the word consumer is, I'm not really even sure if it's legitimate or not, because, you know, the word consume means to consume something or take something in until it is gone. And, you know, so if we're consumers of this planet, you know, we know where we're all heading. But with the word citizen, that's something that I think we can really, like we talked about before, take into our hands. And like you were talking about, Brandon, specifically related to community, because that is what being a citizen means, is that you're a part of something. You're a member of something. You have rights. You have a voice. You have a responsibility to your fellow citizens, and they have a responsibility to you. And it's sort of, I think it's a word that we can use in a positive or in an empowering way. But first we have to also deconstruct the ways that it has been used and then look at practical ways that we can build a citizenry.
So I think there's not a lot of talk about like the premises of consumerism because it's a confused concept. I've never heard a good definition of consumerism. I've never heard a good, it's much like the phrase neoliberal, right? Like everybody uses it and it's like, what what does it mean? It's just kind of a slur at the point that it's used. But if we're going to define it as just like being somebody who's engaging in like a marketplace economy, or if we're going to equate it with materialism, I think it's equated with materialism a lot. And that's a different topic. But if we're going to equate it with just being like somebody in a marketplace economy, I think it's considerably more active than citizenship. Because think about what happens when I'm trying to think of a recent controversy. How quick companies are to jump on correcting course when they do something stupid. I purposely don't watch the news, so I can't think of a recent example myself. But they're much more active as on the company side, and they're much more active, and consumers are much more active, right? I vote every time I go outside and I fill up my tank of gas. I vote every time I walk into Walmart. I vote every time I walk into a certain restaurant. I vote every time I fly a certain airline. I vote every time I turn on my electricity that I get through consumerism. It's considerably more active. I think it's because they, again, if we go back to incentives and institutions, go back to those eyes, big picture, big words, I know. But if we go back to those, the institutions and the incentives are set up for people to be more active. In citizenship, I agree with you, Anna, that citizenship people aren't very active on that either. And I don't think they should be. Every time we've seen throughout history when citizens are very, very active in the states that they're assigned citizenship in, if we're looking at it very formally, very bad things happen. Never. I don't see Coca-Cola launching missiles into Syria. So I just want to push back against that idea. If we're going to use the phrase consumerism, if we're going to use the phrase citizenship, the phrases need to have some kind of definition. If we're just going to equate them with materialism, then that's a different topic. That's a cultural question. And then there's the issue too, like everybody's a consumer. I am a consumer and a capitalist, right? I employ people, but I also consume things. Anybody who goes out into a marketplace and works for anybody else is a consumer, but they're also a producer. So one of the great things about a marketplace economy, even when it gets really nasty and you get a lot of weird things going on, governments propping up failing companies, you know, maybe there's examples from like mid-American history where the government actually like went into Central America, where you are, Lainey, and like fought a war over bananas, right? So there are problems there, but those are also problems of citizenship. So it's definitely two-sided. Again, it's like the phrase neoliberalism. It just doesn't really mean anything.
So when we talk about consumerism, yeah, I wanted to initially when you asked the question, when I think about the question, I was thinking about this thing of love, right? And I was thinking about Eric Fromm in his book All About Love. Is it All About Love or there's a part where he talks about this bartering, and he was using this heterosexual or heteronormative relationship, how you know a guy with money would use his money to almost like an exchange for a woman who is good looking, basically. And there's that exchange, right? And I thought then that makes me think about marginalized folks. If you don't have access to money, how do you find love, right? In this capitalistic sense, right? And then this question of citizenship, I started to think about like here in Canada, where we have the First Nations, and not just in Canada. Like I think Indigenous communities. One thing I've learned in traveling is that Indigenous communities from around the world, they're the first to get like the bad end of the deal, right? So whether in Costa Rica you have the Buruka community that had to traditionally a farming community, you have like these multinationals building these dams all around the world that's affecting how people are living, yeah? But then I was thinking specifically when you think people of color and in a Toronto concept where, you know, on the weekend, I saw there was a Kijiji ad saying that they're renting a room, and the individual said, no black men wanted, right? Or what we're seeing, carding by the police, the Toronto Police Services, and they're carding black men at disproportionate rates compared to any other communities. Or when we look at North America, when we see that in Canada, it's either First Nation or black men that's in the prison system at disproportionate rates. In the States, it's black and Hispanic men, right? Or women. So I think like there's this question of citizenship. And then we see where with the oil sands in Canada, in Fort McMurray in Alberta, where it's been proven that the oil sands are basically, poisoning these indigenous communities that live on this land, basically. But because of profits, the government will not change anything, right? So I think I think this question of consumerism versus citizenship, I think it's a troubling question, because we all have these different entry points to what a citizen is, basically. And also, I think consumerism is sort of what, I think we're all consumers at the end of the day, right? So I think that has that I can see more people say, yeah, I'm a consumer versus I'm a citizen, if that makes any sense, right? So I think that's a really interesting question, but I do think it's harder for some folks to say, yeah, I feel like a citizen. You may have a passport, right? But I don't think that necessarily makes you a citizen either, right? So I think that's something I've been thinking about.
Well, the reason why I bring up this question is it's something I think about almost daily, as we travel through developing nations and different indigenous communities. And I'm always thinking about the cycle of consumerism and what the role is. And I think you bring up a very important point, Brandon. We can be citizens just by owning a passport, but does that really make us a citizen? So this is such a brilliant panel. It was a question or a thought or a concept I just wanted to put to you guys and see where you went with it. And I'm just overwhelmed with the brilliance and perspectives of this panel. You guys are just so amazing. I do want to shift gears and put this in a solution-oriented position as we approach or as we near the end of the show. There'll be a couple more questions and time to give final statements and, of course, share your projects. But what I want for you guys to consider and answer to are, what are your thoughts on some of the values that we need collectively and individually to develop in such a way that'll help us define a changing world, to move into a changing world that we want to see? Because if we're the change makers and if we're the visionaries and we're the ones that are putting our voices out there on the line and working with the communities, let's define what it is that makes those efforts as strong as they are, and how others can be inspired by those sorts of efforts. So who would like to take that next? Which panelist? You're not shy. I know this panel is not shy. Zach, you're up.
Yeah, I'll go ahead. You said what values we need, both individually and like collectively. And I might sound like a broken record player at this point, but I think that collectively the only value you need is some sort of respect for individual values. So if you want to call that individualism, another scary I word, five or six I words I like. But if you want to call that individualism, you can call it individualism. And that doesn't mean atomism, right? That doesn't mean people people going and like locking themselves in their basement with like a huddled over like a mirror of themselves. But what individuals can get together for communities and things like that, so long as those communities aren't forced on them. And then individually, like I said, I think you need self-esteem. I think you need the confidence in yourself and the confidence in your ability to actually carry out what your goals are in the world and see your values manifested in the world to then like create that kind of path. So I can't tell you what individuals need for values, but I can simply tell you that what you need is some sort of society that allows people to go, you know, work together when they want to work together, work individually when they want to work individually, and pursue their ends themselves. So.
And Anna, why don't you chime in next?
Sure. So I'll see if I can kind of build on what Zach is saying without it being contradictory. So that's the challenge, because the values that I see are the most important is the interconnectedness, right? So you have the individualism and the respect for the integrity of the individual and the individual's sovereignty, which I fully agree with. Though at the same time, I see that the interconnectedness and the equality between all beings, all life, is very important, because we, you know, the most important priority must always be maintaining and supporting, nurturing, and hopefully expanding the ecosystem of the planet, because without it, and I know it kind of, it maybe sounds kind of hippie, but I mean, to me, it's just common sense, really. So I don't mean it in any, you know, necessarily a spiritual sense, like I'm being very practical here. So as I see it, the value of always taking the big picture into consideration, which is what is best for all life, and always having that as a frame of reference. And when I say all life, I mean that when we engage with water, you know, that we consider all the water of the earth and the way that water works and the way that everyone needs water and all the plants and the animals. And of course, we can't think in those terms on a very detailed level, but we can do so on more general terms. We can, in our daily lives, we can learn how to think in the sense of, is this something that is best for all? And within that frame of reference, you know, everything goes, you know, you can do what you want within that. But so it's a point of not exclusively looking at individualism, but also looking at what is best for all, not from a dogmatic perspective, like I get to decide on behalf of all of us, but that there is, you know, to understand that there is an optimal way for the planet and for us as human beings to coexist. Sometimes we may have to discover it, we may not yet know. But I really like that, because it has a very, you know, without it becoming controlling and without it becoming about imposing ideologies, that it's a very practical point of reference to have that if we protect the ecosystems and we support the ecosystems, you know, then everyone can benefit, everyone can thrive. So that is my perspective on that. Brandon, I will hand the ball over to you.
Anyways, so I'm gonna jump on both Zach's and Anna's point. Starting with Anna, I think. So you said something. Anna said something about interconnectedness, and it made me think. You know, how I there was a shift in terms of how I started to look at this idea of intersectionality last year, right? And this was a lesson I learned with from my 9-year-old house sister that I was staying with in Costa Rica last year. She taught me like the biggest lesson. Because before, I used to think about intersectionality in terms of like human beings and these communities. But as she started to talk about like these dams that were in her community that was affecting the waterway, that was affecting affecting nature, and how that has an impact on her, basically, right? So she loves animals, and the fact that the dams were affecting the vegetation along the river line, and which was affecting the animals that were coming in the community or even living in the community anymore. And that was somehow like basically killing her heart, right? And I thought that was this really complex and dope idea that this 9-year-old girl was like really sharing with me, right? And I think there has to be that reframing of community as not just human beings, but also with nature, right? And I think so. The other piece around that is also empathy. To Zach's point around self-esteem, I think that is like super key. But again, I think there is different entry points, right? So if I'm queer, or if I'm First Nation, or marginalized, or as a Black man, if I'm living in constant hate because society hates me, then I think it's also it's still a bit tricky to learn to love, like loving myself, right? And having self-confidence, right? So I think self-esteem is super key. However, I think it's not as easy for folks, and not to say like, you know, like it's impossible, but I think we have to really be practical. We have to have these dialogues about how do we love ourselves, right? How do we practice self-love? How do we love externally? And be authentic about it, right? And I think it's like constantly working. And again, these are not things that my kids are learning in school. These are not things I'm learning in university. I think we have to, you know, we have to go back to community and have these dialogues, right? So yeah, I think to walk my two walk away is intersectionality that includes human beings, but also nature, and basically this idea of self-esteem, but working at it, like it's this constant piece, and it's this thing of love, right? Like for this authentic love, I think it. I don't know how that works with this structure that we're in, this capitalistic structure that we're in, basically, right, which kind of convolutes everything, you know what I'm saying?
Wow, thank you. This show went to places I didn't expect, but I had hoped. It's been a beautiful, absolutely beautiful panel. And I think that we could explore lifelong learning for a changing world for another 2 hours. I really think it's possible. There's a lot that we didn't touch on. I'd like to go to each of our panelists, though, and give you each the opportunity to give any closing remarks or any follow-up to the last round of conversation. And also, I'd like for each of you to share your links and your projects at the end of your closing remark as well. So why don't we jump over to Zach first?
Sure. I can talk a little bit about my projects. And I can also, there's just one question I like to, when we get into these discussions, especially ones about the ecosystem, and your original question about what values we need, I am hesitant to agree with, there are a lot of good points made across the board. And I agree with Brandon's point about, you know, people need to have open discussions about practicing self-love. One of my favorite authors was, he just recently died. His name's Nathaniel Brandon. And he actually wrote a book on like romantic love, and he writes stuff on self-esteem, really great, top-notch stuff. But extending from that too, I don't know how you can have a value system, and I'm not like asking for debate, I'm just throwing this out there, that's kind of a response. I don't know how you can have a value system that isn't subordinate to human life and human flourishing. You need some sort of system that is relative to valuers, and human beings are the only creatures that can value. So it doesn't make sense to subordinate human well-being to non-human well-being in my mind. That was my follow-up to that very last point. So I guess if there was one value as a society, it would be human flourishing. I think human flourishing is incredibly important. I think that comes down to self-esteem on the individual level. So Praxis is my primary project. And like you noted during the introduction, Lainey, I am a founding team member, and I'm currently the business development director for it. And what we do with Praxis is we take young people ages 18 to 25, and we give them a real-world education. We let them step outside the classroom. We help them break the mold. And what we do with that is it's year-long. They go and they work at a small to medium-sized business. It's an interesting industry, so it's not like they're necessarily working at the bakery down the street, or they work at a startup somewhere. They work at one of these two kinds of businesses, and they work closely with entrepreneurs. They work closely with people who founded businesses. They work closely with CEOs, people who built businesses and are currently building businesses, to see what it's like. And they get to engage in kind of like this marketplace of education that I mentioned earlier. While they do that, they're working 30 hours a week and they're getting paid while they do that. And my job is to go find the companies. So I love my job. I get to meet interesting people who build stuff. I think work and work ethic are like the two most important things for somebody to actually live a happy life. So I get to meet really interesting people. And while they're doing that, they're doing an education component that it consists of personal and professional development. Our education director, TK Coleman, who I would suspect that anybody watching this would love TK. TK is the brain, the mastermind behind all of that. So what we're trying to provide to people is a lot of our participants don't have college degrees. They don't want to get college degrees. They want to go and they want to build something. They see sitting around for 4 years as a waste of their time and potentially a waste of their money. So that's my primary project. I write, and that's at discoverpraxis.com, P-R-A-X-I-S. And then I write on, deschooling. I've been doing some side projects on like the moral psychology of love. So like some really fun stuff related to a lot of stuff that was wrapped into here. And that's at my own personal site. That's just sexlayback.com, C-A-K-S-L-A-Y-B-A-C-K.com.
Thank you for that, Zach. So who would like to go next? Branda? Branda or Anna?
I can just go quickly. So Black Daddies Club. We've been around since 2007. I started the organization based on just my own personal needs as a Black father. So we have three mandates. The first is to create safe spaces, and I use that term safe space very loosely, but create space for Black men and Black fathers to talk about issues that affect us as parents, and that speaks to the isolation piece. The second mandate is to work with media and create our own media that depicts Black fathers in a more positive light. So that goes to the power of storytelling. And third is around education. So going into schools, creating film, and just different platforms in terms of just to have communication, basically. A lot of the work that we are moving towards is sort of like reimagining what, higher education is, right? So I don't know how many of your listeners or even you guys have seen, there's this popular baseball movie called Field of Dreams, right? And there's a line in it, if you build it, they will come. And I see the work that we're doing with Black fathers is not, if you build it, they won't come, right? Like you have to, you build it. If you're working with moms, I don't want to generalize it, but if you're working with mothers, I find like that probably work. If you have a solid moms program, mothers will come and travel if they find it relevant. Where with men, specifically Black fathers, what we found is that you have to build it and then bring it to where they're at and then engage them, right? So when we start and still now, we go into barbershops, or we may even go into prisons, or we may go to where folks are living, like go into like the basements of apartments and do a discussion session, basically, because also recognizing that accessibility is also an issue for a lot of these men who don't necessarily. It's either I pay for a token to come out to your session, or I go to work the next day. You know what I'm saying? Not to make it so dire hard, but it's also the reality of it, right? So it's constantly trying to be creative of how to engage these men. And also the work we do is through a lot of partnerships, right? So we have these initiatives called Daddies and Me, where we get these tickets donated, whether it's for like art, sports, where dads and their kids can come out and we go as a group. The dads don't pay anything. And it's all about community building, essentially, right? So it's really how to not just connections or community building with these dads, right? So some of these kids will call me uncle, or my kids may call another dad uncle. I have three boys, so if I have to take one to the washroom, I'll ask, you know, another dad to watch all three of my kids, and vice versa, right? So it's this really cool thing. Like if I'm on the road, I may see a kid is like, "Hey, Uncle Brandon," and it's this really good feeling that you're feeling that you're making community, right? And I think for me as a father, that's like super important for my kids to have that. It's yeah, and I think that's it goes back to what Anna spoke about and we were talking about early on. I think it's really about creating these new systems that works for me, basically, and works for my community, right? So yeah.
Beautiful. Thank you so much for sharing, Brandon. And I do have to tell our audience that you gave a wonderful TED Talk that's available online. So just Google Brandon's name if you want to hear more about his Daddy's Club. So yeah, it was a great talk and I was just so impressed. And Anna, I'd like to hand the floor over to you. Please share with us any closing remarks you may have. And do share with us as well your projects and your websites and so forth.
Yeah, so at the moment, for the past 4 years, I've been I'm calling it, I'm hacking the education system. So I'm basically working as a teacher while at the same time expose the education system and blog about it on A Teacher's Journey to Life. And I've been doing that for the past 4 years. And I'm working on turning my blogs into a book. And then I've also just started up my own company called Bricks Education, where I do talks. And we are also selling an educational technology called the Technotutor that basically aims at giving the child education into their own hands. Everything that we've been talking about tonight, where the child can become completely self-empowered and self-directed. And where education can potentially be taken out of schools and into the home, and where parents can become much more involved. So I'm very excited about that. Yeah, I think that as a closing remark, I will say just to wrap up the conversation that we have that we had before in terms of working, you know, the conflict between individualism and community. And how we tend to experience community as being, you know, imposing control on individuals. And, you know, personally, I don't at all see that as a conflict. And I think that it's, you know, as I said early on, it's kind of like we're still in kindergarten here as humanity. And I think that's a really important thing to consider, you know, to not see ourselves as these all-knowing universal beings, but to, you know, be humble towards the fact that we don't know a lot about life or about living together or coexisting. And I think that what Brandon and Zach is doing is really important, to get involved in one's local community and actually doing a physical difference that has practical impact. And that you're doing as well, Lainey, with what you're doing with Miro and with your world schooling project. And I think that's really important for everyone that's interested in this subject to find a project or give themselves a life purpose, which Zach was also talking about, that gives self-esteem to you, but that can also help to empower others. And if each of us do that, it's a numbers game, where 1 + 1 + 1 + 1 equals the total difference in the end.
Thank you. Thank you, Anna. And what a pleasure it was to have each and every one of these guests on the panel tonight. I am so incredibly grateful for your participation and for sharing your authentic perspectives and really making this a dynamic conversation that's going to give me a lot to think about. So I learned a lot from each one of you. Thank you. I'm humbled for that. Before we wrap, I want to go ahead and thank Mel and Vicky over at the Conscious Consumer Network. We are so incredibly grateful to have this platform to be able to broadcast week after week and have these conversations. And you're bringing an incredible voice in alternative media to the masses. And I couldn't be happier to be a part of this. And anybody who's watching who believes and supports or believes in the vision and mission of alternative media, please support the station. They're always looking for support. It's a self-funded station, and we're funded by the viewers as well. So please, if you can, follow the links on the Conscious Consumer Network to help to support the station. Finally, I'd like to thank my producer, Nina. You're always so intuitive with putting together these panels, and I could not do this work without your love and support. So thank you so much. So wherever you are and whatever you do, continue always doing it for the love of learning.
If you really had to make a difference on a large scale with minimal resources, how would you go about it? Have you ever dared to dream of doing that which seems impossible? On a planet steeped with corruption and destruction, the question beckons, how do we change it? Media has a far-reaching impact on people and has been used to manipulate humanity into our current destructive patterns. In order to affect people into moving into constructive patterns of behavior, we need to construct a new paradigm of media. Human Network has been created with the explicit intention of giving the amazing truth-seeking, solutions-orientated alternative media a place to fully realize their true potential with a cutting-edge, high-tech professional media platform. In turn, some of the greatest freedom-seeking hearts and souls of our time have realized the true potential of what has been created and have come together to provide their insight and inspiration on CCN. Conscious Consumer Network has become a unique, interactive information and educational network which provides a free-to-view, live-stream, ultra-high-definition channel to the world and features 25 live shows a week and growing with the addition of multiple language broadcasts. CCN has features comparable with mainstream media, such as being able to pause and rewind broadcasts whilst being live-streamed. Catch up on missed or previous broadcasts, now available from CCN High Definition Downloads. You can now purchase a high definition download of your favorite CCN show from effiemarket.com. Support free and independent media by becoming a monthly pledger. This can be done with a monthly pledge of 10 euros, which will allow you unlimited access to CCN's High Definition Downloads, which hosts a back catalogue of over 250 shows, which have been aired since the launch of CCN on the 1st of January 2015. In order to keep CCN on the air, public funding is needed. Please donate to CCN's Network Support Fund or become a monthly pledger. Help keep alternative media in the hands of the people. We thank you for supporting free and independent media.